Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to the 13th Longford Lecture. And 13 may be unlucky for some, but for us it's extremely lucky, because this, I think, is going to be one of the most stimulating lectures, and there's quite a challenge to win on that. This is certainly one of the most exciting that we've staged. Frank Longford, I think he would have been reduced to tears tonight by what we are going to hear, because it is absolutely at the core of his belief about what could be done in prison. He was a most remarkable man. What was so extraordinary is that, of course, although there are a reasonable number of greyheads here, the fact is most people don't know who Frank Longford was. And he was sort of part bonkers, part absolutely exceptional intellect, and absolutely dynamic and original character. He was one of the first ministers to Germany, and so keen was he to get going with the Germans after the war and rebuild and the rest of it, that he stepped off the plane before they'd put the steps up, and I think broke his ankle, if I'm not wrong. But he was a wonderful man. He gave me the first job I ever had working at the New Horizon Youth Center, and I'm indebted to him to this day. I remain the chairman of the New Horizon even now. That was a day center for homeless and vulnerable teenagers. So we tonight have the director of the Swedish prison system, Nils Oberg, and he is a man who's held this job for 2 years, but he's been in the justice system for a further 12 years before that, and his commitment has been to humanizing the prison system. He's got the population down to what in this country, this is the prison population. If he had been doing what he has done in Sweden here, we would have not 87,000 prisoners, but 30,000 prisoners. He has as many people in prison, admittedly in a population of 10 million, but he has as many people in prison as we have women in prison. And that's a pretty extraordinary thought. I'm absolutely delighted to introduce him and ask him very soon to present his speech. But before we do, we've got some other lovely things to do, which he will witness and which will perhaps elevate the moment by his being here. I want to thank the Daily Telegraph, without whom we could not stage this evening. Their sponsorship is invaluable, and their coverage online has been terrific. And Charlie Porter, who is very kindly funding a lot of tonight, the Prison Reform Trust, and I now want to hand over to Liz Hunt, Deputy Editor of The Telegraph, to say a few words on behalf of The Telegraph.
Thank you, John. Good evening, and a very warm welcome to the 13th Longford Lecture on behalf of The Telegraph. My first task this evening is to apologise for the absence of the editor, Chris Evans, who is unable to attend because of a prior engagement. However, I know he would want me to say how delighted we are to continue as media sponsors of the Longford Lecture, and even more delighted that this year it is again a sellout. I would like to think that, along with the pulling power of our esteemed speaker this evening, Nils Oberg, the broad reach of the Telegraph had something to do with the fact that we have a sellout. The Longford Trust is not, in the minds of most people, an obvious fit for the Telegraph. Prison and social reform are subjects that do not sit comfortably with the stereotypical perception, an erroneous one, of our hang'em and flog'em readership. But when the director of the Trust, Peter Stanford, approached us back in 2012 to ask if we would consider taking over media sponsorship of the Longford Lecture, there was no hesitation on our part. At that first lecture, the speaker was Will Self. I was accosted by a member of the audience at the reception afterwards. She stalked up to me and barked, "When I walked in here and saw the Telegraph's name and the banners, I nearly walked out again." There was a pause. I waited for what I hoped would be the but. It didn't come. She stalked off. You are quite rightly a demanding sort of audience, and she was giving no quarter. However, I did take comfort from the fact that she had stayed on for the lecture, despite the disapproval of the Telegraph's involvement. I hope she came last year, and I hope she's here tonight. You know who you are. Lord Longford believed in the value of punishment, but saw it as a route to the three R's: reform, rehabilitation, and redemption, whether the latter is a secular interpretation or faith-based. How could any sensible, compassionate person who cares about our society disagree with that? Certainly the Telegraph doesn't. I would like to hand back to John Snow, who's our MC tonight, as you know. Thank you, and please enjoy the evening.
Thank you again, Liz, and thank you to the Daily Telegraph. Let's now go to one of their esteemed columnists, Mary Riddell, who is also one of the judges of the Longford Prize, and she'll come up to announce the winners of the 2014 Longford Prize.
John, thank you very much indeed. And could I just add my welcome to that of John and of Liz on behalf of the Prison Reform Trust, the Longford Trust, and of course the Daily Telegraph, the newspaper for which I am lucky enough to write. And I do promise you that, as some people in the hall will know, I am not part of the Hang'em and Flog'em fraternity. I don't think very many people on the Telegraph are. It's our great pleasure, as Liz has said, to be involved in these great awards, and my particular pleasure as a first-time judge to have the honour of announcing them this evening. So may I start with our first award tonight, the Lifetime Achievement Award, which goes to the New Horizon Youth Centre. This is the citation. Usually reserved for an individual, this year the judges recognise the achievements and ongoing work of the New Horizon Youth Centre in North London, founded by Lord Longford in 1968. Over five decades, this drop-in day centre has maintained an unwavering focus on needy, homeless, alienated and desperate young people. They can count on it when they can count on no one else. Its doors are always open, its welcome always warm, and its programs continue to evolve to answer every new challenge, including its current highly successful Creating Positive Futures project. So I'd like to invite Sheila O'Connor, the director of New Horizon, up on stage, please, to collect the award.
Say a word of clarification. I had no hand in this at all, and neither did the spirit of Lord Longford. We kept both of them out of the equation. It genuinely is the most sensational project, and we're incredibly grateful. Now I'll put my other hat on, which has nothing to do with New Horizon. Mary.
I can absolutely vouch on behalf of all the judges for the impartiality of John Snow in this. We all actually had a really difficult job. I should have said at the outset, the quality of entries was, as ever, very, very high this year. We were hard put to reach a decision simply because of the quality. I think in the end we were unanimous, and we did decide unanimously that we had to give this year two highly commended awards, of which the first goes to Mona Morrison. In their citation, the judges wrote, "Mona Morrison, the judges believe, is a remarkable and courageous individual who's saving lives through her work with gangs, and especially around the often hidden issue of the sexual exploitation of young people, sometimes children, involved in gangs. Drawing on her own lifetime experiences, Mona's been able, as part of the St. Giles Trust, to establish relationships of trust with vulnerable and traumatized youngsters who might otherwise be beyond the reach of official agencies, and so to transform their lives. I'd like to invite Mona Morrison on stage, please, to collect her award." second highly commended award tonight is a first, I think, for the Longford Trust. It goes to Product of Prison, and in their citation, the judges wrote, "For the first time, the judges are making an award to an overseas organisation because they're keen to draw attention to the extraordinary rehabilitation work of this small Dutch NGO with prisoners in Uganda. It's brave, practical, and innovative, operating in circumstances unimaginable in the UK. It creates new futures for individuals whose lives are often torn apart by hostility and rejection once they're released from jails. Product of Prison is based in Kampala, but representing the organisation here tonight, we have, I hope, Michael Wickham and Matt Morgan from Forward Foundation, who are funders of Product of Prison, both of whom recently visited its projects in Uganda. I'd like to invite them both up on stage, please, to collect the award. And so finally, our winner for tonight. Again, we had a hard job deciding out of an excellent field, but were in the end unanimous in deciding that the winner of the Longford Prize 2014 should be the Forgiveness Project. The judges wrote, "Having highly commended the Forgiveness Project in 2007, we this year award it the Longford Prize to salute the development of its work, especially its innovative and challenging Restore Offender Intervention Programme. This is having a real and proven impact on changing how those prisoners who take part in jails around the country think about themselves and their crime. The Forgiveness Project, now in its 10th year, lives out in a practical, effective way the core belief of Lord Longford in every individual's potential for rehabilitation. It's making a significant contribution to reducing reoffending, as well as having a wider impact in creating a more positive commitment in our criminal justice system to restorative justice." So I'd like finally to invite Marina Cantacuccino, the founder of the Forgiveness Project, up on stage to receive the award and say a few words to you. She's going to talk for about 5 minutes. So, Marina.
Thank you so much. I first of all just want to sincerely thank the Longford Trust and the judges for awarding the prize this year to the Forgiveness Project. We are all incredibly excited about it. I also want to thank the person who nominated us, Peter Dawson, who is the former governor of Highdown Prison, where we worked for many years and delivered the programme, and whose enthusiasm and encouragement has been unparalleled. I founded the Forgiveness Project 10 years ago in the aftermath of the Iraq War, when the public discourse was almost entirely focused on payback and retaliation. And as a journalist, I wanted to redress the balance by sharing stories of restoration and recovery. So that's what the Forgiveness Project does. We share stories from victims, survivors, who have reconciled with their pain and the trauma, perhaps even with the offenders. We share stories of perpetrators who have used their aggression, who have transformed their aggression into a force for peace. And the Restore Programme, which is the Prison Offender Programme, really helps offenders change the narrative of their lives. It comes under the Victim Empathy Restorative Justice umbrella. And it's an intensive group-based intervention which encourages offenders to examine concepts of forgiveness and reparation in a framework that fosters greater accountability. And it is, I think, uniquely facilitated by both a victim of crime and an ex-offender alongside each other, so really modelling a restorative process. For the victim survivor, sharing their story in the group is not just something they do for others, but it's part of their own recovery. For the ex-offender, it's about using his or her story to help those still in the system gain a vision of what they might become. And then the offender participants share their story, and it is the whole process is a chance for them to reflect, to rethink and rebuild their lives. And over the past 7 years, we've worked with adult male offenders, we've worked with young offenders, we've worked in probation, and we're just starting to work in women's prisons in Gloucester with a group called InfoBuzz. And next year, we're also working with veterans with another group called Forward Assist, first time in the community. Delivering restore to other vulnerable groups besides offenders has become a key aim for the Forgiveness Project. Because we are now in the brave new world of the transforming rehabilitation agenda, where no small voluntary sector organisation can be sure to find a place. And I finally just want to end with just a few tiny little brief snapshots of who is involved in this powerful work. So there's a prisoner who did a course in Guy's Marsh and who kept writing to us and saying, when I come out, I want to deliver this programme. He has been delivering the programme for 2 years now, and he's in the room tonight. The forward-thinking governor in Park Prison in Wales, who heard countless reports from prisoners and officers about the powerful impact of the Restore programme, and fixed for her own staff to do this, not only to help bring some peace and well-being to their lives, but also so they could better support the prisoners in their care. The prison officer, who started off at the back of the room and then was so moved and motivated by what we were doing, went part-time and came and facilitated with us as well. And Marion Partington, whose sister was killed by Fred and Rosemary West, who has shared her story with countless groups of men, often very violent. And when she does this, she hands around a tiny hand-spun bag woven with stray sheep's wool that her sister made and gave to her when they were children. And by sharing and trusting countless strangers to hold this most precious and delicate gift, I think Marion somehow manages to transform this story of hell into a message of hope, and I've seen that happen so many times. And finally, Anthony Turner, languishing in jail, an IPP prisoner for 6 years, over tariff, did the course in Haidan in 2007, writes fairly frequently, full of hope, and he said in his last letter that Wrapped and the Forgiveness Project were the two organizations that had turned his life around, allowing him, and I quote, to put guilt, shame, pain, and regret to a place where it doesn't dictate my choices anymore. So I just want to say thank you again for this award. It means a huge amount for me personally, but also to all the storytellers, facilitators, and beneficiaries of Restore, for whom this Longford Prize actually really is for. So thank you very much.
When the trustees of the Longford Trust were told about Nils Oberg and his views and what he had apparently achieved, we were so dubious that such a man could exist and that such an achievement could have been wrought that we dispatched Maggie and Peter straight, Rachel and Peter, off to Stockholm to inspect him. And of course, they were completely captivated by him and captivated by what he'd achieved. And we therefore thought, we must bring him here. We must expose our prison system to what he has to say. Because he does believe that basically, well, he'll tell us, but I mean, he believes what everybody in this room believes, which is, of course, that the deprivation of freedom is the punishment, and that thereafter you're dealing with human beings. And that is right at the core of his being. And I'm very humbled to present to you tonight our 13th Longford Lecturer, Nils Oberg, Director of the Swedish Prison System. Nils.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, John, for your kind introduction, and thank you for raising the expectations of what I have to say to an impossible level. But I will do my best. I am deeply honored to be able to contribute in this modest way to the legacy of Lord Longford. I'm thrilled and thankful that so many of you have come to listen tonight. I would like, for the next half hour or so, tell you about the work of the Swedish Prison and Probation Service. I will share with you some of our current hopes, fears, and frustrations. My ambition is to describe how we care for some of the most vulnerable people in our Swedish welfare society. And by doing so, I hope to convince you that we are indeed making an important contribution to the safety and security of our society. But let me first offer some words of caution and qualifications. I will not in any way claim that the way we do things in Sweden is the only solution to the challenges that we all face in this area. Our work is carried out in many different ways around the world, even in countries that are very similar, and so it must be. Our political contexts and legal systems are very different, as are the general conditions under which we carry out our work. What I can say is that we believe that our model works for us and that it has served us well for a long time. It may also be worth pointing out that in Sweden, individual members of government are constitutionally prohibited from interfering with the way we, as a public service, carry out our work. The government, not a minister, defines our overall goals, and the parliament provides the legal framework and the funds to get the job done. How we carry out our work in detail is, in every aspect not defined by law, entirely up to us and our responsibility. That differs our system considerably to many other political systems also in Europe. We therefore have a great deal of freedom, both in terms of how we organize ourselves and the working strategies we develop. More importantly, it provides a clear division of labor between the political level and the public administration. In policy areas where there are often strong political opinions, this has proven to be very beneficial. For my service, the system secures our ability over time to implement our strategies consistently. In other words, we have the power to stick with the ideas we believe in. Over 10 million people are imprisoned throughout the world today. And let me start by saying that I believe that many of them are precisely in the place they should be. I do not for a minute agree with those who claim that prison systems don't work by default. That's simply wrong. They work just fine, provided you have the right prisoner in them and your idea is to make people better, not worse. Having said that, when you start taking that figure apart, you will soon discover that it covers a very diversified group of people. Some are in prison because of their political or religious beliefs, and they should never have been put there in the first place. Many have not even officially been charged with a crime, and they spend year after year waiting for a trial that may or may not come. The Swedish author and journalist Dawit Isaak is one of them. He has now spent more than 12 years in a prison in Eritrea, still without being charged of any specific crime. And for the past 8 years, no one has had any information about him. and he shares that fate with thousands of political prisoners around the world. Let's also remember that a number of these 10 million individuals are children. Some have indeed broken the law, but most of them are in prison because one or both of their parents have been incarcerated and left them with nowhere else to go. We are therefore not looking at a group of 10 million criminals. We're talking about 10 million individuals. And despite their differences, all of them have several things in common. First, most of them are in pretrial detention centers and prisons that were designed to break people down, not prepare them for reintegration into society. But almost all of them will one day return back to life in society, wherever that is. The overwhelming majority of all prisoners will also be in a poorer physical and psychological shape than they were when they were incarcerated. And the fourth thing they have in common is that they will all be stigmatized and ill seen by the rest of civil society when they are released. Last but not least, none of them are happy with their situation. They may not overtly and convincingly argue for their wish for a change, but they certainly don't argue the opposite either. There is therefore always, in my opinion, potential for change. But why pay attention to the prison situation in countries far away from our own? Do we not have enough headache as it is? Well, one of the points that I would like to make tonight is that how penal sanctions are carried out should be a matter of interest and concern also to the international community. An increasing number of people throughout the world can and will travel long distances in search for a better life for themselves and their families. Also, broken people with criminal records will do so. This will, and already does, affect the criminal justice sector in our societies. To me, this is not a hypothesis, but a reality and a fact that I can see firsthand when we carry out our duties in the service in Sweden. I think it was one of your former and world-famous prime ministers who once said, "Show me your prisons and I will tell you what society you live in." And that statement is still very valid today. Prison conditions in many parts of the world are nothing short of a humanitarian catastrophe waiting to erupt. I mention this not to add to the darkness of things, but actually to bring a little light into the discussion. I can see some quite remarkable developments in our field of work in many different parts of the world today. Let me just mention one of them. I've just returned from a visit to Namibia, where I had a series of meetings with African prison and probation officers and colleagues. It became very clear to me that in many of the countries on that continent, there is now significant progress made. The most important one is that our business is being handed over from the military and police to its rightful place in the judicial system. Professional services are being forged with a strong set of humanitarian values, and the reintegration goals they have defined appear to be very similar to our own. The importance of this can hardly be overstated. It may appear as insignificant in a European context, as we passed that point long time ago. But I assure you, it is very encouraging for the future of prison policies and human rights in Africa, and we should actively support it. My point is that challenges in our business are similar wherever in the world they appear. Designing criminal justice systems is about making choices, and the same hard choices, whatever political and legal context. The bad news is that you need to think very hard before you make any of these choices. The decisions you need to take are seldom comfortable, whether in Africa, in Sweden, or in the UK. Often they involve challenging strong public opinions, and you can be quite certain that the choices you make, whichever they are, will be very costly. The good news, however, is that there are only a few such choices to be made. In terms of cracking codes in prison and probation systems, two of them are fundamental. And let me explain how we have dealt with them in my jurisdiction. The first and most important one is about deciding whether you give priority to custodial or non-custodial penalties. In other words, do you incarcerate people with a rush, or do you try to keep people out of prison as long as possible and use alternative sanctions instead? To our profession, the answer is very clear. The use of imprisonment must always be the very last resort, not your first preferred option. When I meet colleagues from other countries, we spend time comparing data on incarceration rates, admission rates, cost per inmate, and percentages of reoffending. That's how we benchmark our work. And the underlying ambition of every prison service I know is to keep prison numbers to a very minimum. I don't think that's a coincidence. We know better than most others what the human costs of incarceration is. We see it firsthand every day in our work. That, however, is rarely how society at large sees it. An American colleague once described this paradox in the following way. He said, "In the United States, we put people in jail not because they're bad, but because we're mad." And that's, I think, a good illustration not only of the situation in the United States. There is quite a bit of that kind of madness also in the public debate in my own country from time to time. And when that happens, it tends to cloud the political debate on the purposes and the role of prison and probation systems. And it also makes it difficult sometimes for politicians to keep a sharp focus on strategies that actually work. I guess this is one of the recurring dilemmas we're faced with as a profession, wherever in the world we operate. We are, on the one hand, civil servants loyal to our governments and the political environment. But on the other hand, we are also a profession. We are experts on prison and probation. And as such, we must, from time to time, allow ourselves to speak up and challenge public opinion and political opportunism. It is always painful and often uncomfortable, but it must be done. I might add that I'm quite impressed with the way this is currently being done in North America. Some very courageous American colleagues are taking a firm stand on prison policies on the other side of the Atlantic, in particular the excessive use of solitary confinement, or administrative segregation, as they call it, is being questioned and openly criticized. In several parts of Europe, efforts are now made to substantially reduce prison numbers. Electronic monitoring has become popular in jurisdictions that for many years have rejected that system without further ado. Alternatives such as community supervision are being introduced, as well as the concept of low security prisons. On the surface, it may indeed appear as a new and encouraging development. It would seem that countries are trying hard to move away from overcrowded prisons to more diversified and comprehensive strategies for carrying out penal sanctions. Now, the interesting questions are why and why now? Is it a coincidence or is it for real? Why all of a sudden are non-custodial sanctions perceived as a valid option in places where the opposite was true only a few years ago? Why this sudden change of heart? There are, I think, at least three different answers to that question. The first answer is that it is simply a response to the financial crisis and national budget cuts. In such cases, it has in fact little or nothing to do with shifts in ideology or criminal justice policy. General cuts in public spending is affecting also prison and probation systems. In some jurisdictions, there have been 20 to 30% financial reductions over a period of only a few years. And in those cases, one might of course suspect that strategies are likely to shift again once the financial situation so permits. But let me be clear on one thing. I do not think that economically driven reforms and criminal political reforms are necessarily a bad thing. On the contrary, as a colleague once put it, why waste a good crisis if it can be used for a good cause? I'm all for pragmatism, and even short-sighted strategies are welcome, if only the outcome is good. Colleagues in Ireland, for example, have managed to finally introduce new legislation against putting children in prison. This was done in a response to a political decision to significantly reduce prison numbers. And as a result, the St. Patrick's Prison for Juvenile Offenders in Dublin has at last been closed. The second answer to the question is that there are now some serious attempts to reduce prison numbers as a reaction to a long history of over-incarceration. That is, for example, the case, I would say, in many of the states in the US. Excessive costs are usually a consequence of this, but does not always have to be. And in the case of North America, a new and important discussion on who should be in prison and who should not be there is now underway. And that discussion is about justice, it's about fairness and proportionality, not economy. But the third answer has nothing to do with numbers or money. It is instead based on the conviction that reducing prison numbers to a minimum is the right thing to do, particularly in a long-term effort to enhance safety and security in society. Also here, there are some new and noteworthy trends. Japan, for example, has recently introduced parole in their criminal system. And as a consequence, the Japanese government is building up a sizable probation service. Canada is, as usual, in the front line of things and has developed a new groundbreaking concept for structuring the dialogue and meetings between a parolee and his or her probation officer in a more effective way. That is also very, very encouraging. I think it's fair to say that in these jurisdictions, the changes we see are based on documented and scientifically supported evidence that probation is simply a more effective penal sanction than prison sentences can ever hope to be. It simply produces better results. In Sweden, we made that choice a long time ago. We have been given priority to probation and alternative penal sanctions and imprisonment for many years now. We have had time to develop our skills and methods, carrying out community services, supervision, electronic monitoring, probation or mandatory treatment. We have made good progress in all of these areas, and I believe that we now have a system that is credible, which is very, very important, and it works well for us. We're also in the process of developing them even further, and we gladly share these experiences with others. But you will ask, is it really working? Have we cracked the code? Do we see a change? Are we indeed contributing to making our society a safer place? Well, my answer is yes. I believe we do. Unfortunately, I have little hard scientific evidence to support that statement. Our reoffending figures remain quite stable over time. About one third of our offenders, 30%, come back to serve another penalty in our prison and probation service within 3 years. That's a reasonably good figure by any international standard. But if you count everyone who reoffend, including those charged with a fine, the figure is about 40%, which is still not a bad result. The frustrating part, however, is that those figures have remained more or less unchanged for a long period of time. And it would suggest that the impact of all the progress we have made in our work has a rather limited impact on reoffending. But since a few years now, there are signs that may suggest that things are indeed changing. Our admission figures, not only to prisons, but to our entire prison and probation service, are dropping significantly. They are down this year by approximately 6% and have been doing so on a yearly basis since 2011. What can possibly explain this? It has come quite unexpectedly, and we have completely and miserably failed as a service to predict this trend shift. The honest answer is that we still don't really know for sure. But let me mention at least a couple of educated guesses. The first one is that the courts are sentencing in a more lenient way, particularly for drug offenses. That we know for a fact. We're not quite sure why, but we know that that is one explanation. We also have a Supreme Court ruling from 2011 lowering the sentences for very serious drug offenses by more than one third. Now that means that over time, the total number of prison years will go down significantly. The second possible factor has to do with efficiency in policing and crime fighting. We are currently reorganizing our entire police organization, and this fact will probably explain why there is a lower degree of efficiency in criminal investigations, and that will probably explain, at least in part, why there's a lower input into the judiciary as a whole. What we do know is that this drop in admission has not been the result of an explicit political ambition in our country to empty our prisons. On the contrary, the center-right-wing coalition government that we've had over the past 8 years have been tough on crime and keen to criminalize. And it has introduced a series of criminal reforms packages, including increased penalties for serious crimes. But whichever way you look at it, I am convinced that the very long-term strategic choice to give priority to probation and non-custodial sentences is now having a positive effect. We will have to wait a little while longer to be able to confirm this, but in the meantime, we have been able to permanently close down some of our oldest and most run-down prisons and remand centers, and I can assure you that they will be missed by no one. Let me now turn to the second of the two choices that I mentioned earlier. If the first one is whether you give priority to prison or alternative sanctions, the second one is what do you do with the people who, after all, should end up in prison? In other words, once you have the right people in prison, what do you actually do with them? Our Swedish strategy is founded on a few relatively simple principles, all of which I believe will sound familiar to you. The first one is to control our prisons, and the second one is to make every day in prison count. And the third point is that we treat human beings and not criminals. Allow me to elaborate on those three points a little, for they are very, very important to us. Now, taking control of prisons is primarily about good prison management and good leadership, not perimeter security and technology. Our staff operate our prisons and remand centers. They are not run by the prisoners placed in them. That may seem an obvious thing to say, but it has not always been so in my country. Staff is nowadays the single most important component in what we call our dynamic security strategy. It is true that we also have invested heavily in CCTVs, X-ray machines, concrete walls and barbed wire, and all of those things. But they are first and foremost there as a complement to and to support our staff and their difficult work. We have set our security goals very high. We accept no drugs, no alcohol, no contraband, no threats, no violence, and no destruction of property in our pre-trial remand centers and our prisons. It has required some very tight security regimes to achieve that, and obviously not everyone has been very happy with that over the years. But the result speaks for itself. The last drug screening we have made shows less than 1% of intoxication amongst our inmates. Only a few years ago, or 5 to 6 years ago, that figure was much, much higher. As I'm sure in the UK, staff-prisoner relations is what makes the difference. We want our prison officers to be with the prisoners everywhere they are and throughout the whole day. For this to work, there needs to be a set of very clear and very strong core values that underpin our daily work. I cannot overstate the importance of this. Let me give you just one example of how that works in practice. I recently overheard a prison manager addressing a group of new recruits. She was introducing them to the world of remand centers and prisons. And she began her presentation saying, "If you want to work on my team, you have to like all kinds of people." That captures, I think, much of our core values in a nutshell. If you don't like people of a particular kind, you cannot be part of our team. We are very, very clear on that point. If you are afraid of inmates, if you are indifferent to them as individuals and human beings, or in any way disrespect them or look down on them because of the situation they are in, well then you are by default disqualified from being part of our service. We run an operation where unconditional respect for inmates and clients is fundamental to everything we do in our service. It is not subject to compromise. It must be imprinted throughout the entire organization, and it is a non-negotiable. This is, of course, easy to say and much more difficult to achieve. In particular, since the role of prison officers in Sweden is a dual one and therefore very complex. On the one hand, they are representatives of the criminal justice system, charged with carrying out criminal sanctions, sometimes with the use of force. They are upholding law and order within our premises and therefore control as well as prevent new crimes from being committed and additional victims of crime. But they are also part of our fundamental supportive environment. Positive and reinforcing interaction with the inmates is vital. They talk, they listen, they reason, and they guide. They are, in many ways, the role models our inmates have never had in their lives. Let me be clear on that point. We do not ask for the impossible. No one can like everyone all the time. That's not the point. There are many daily situations where staff need to correct and intervene firmly, and they will receive no appreciation in return. Of course, there are conflicts, anger, and exchanges of harsh words, and even more difficult conflicts than that. But they will, during their careers, also be exposed to endless trauma, sadness, human disaster, and personal disappointments. A strong faith in people's capacity to change, therefore, has to be deeply embedded in our professional value systems. In this respect, I am very proud of my organization. The relations between our staff and our clients are healthy and remarkably respectful. The second important aspect of our strategy is to make every day in prison count. In our system, we have relatively short prison sentences. Approximately 80% of our inmates are sentenced to penalties of less than a year's duration. Given that they have several serious problems in their lives, and that they've had these problems for a long, long time, the window of opportunity that we have to create a change is very, very small. Only with a strong supporting environment, as we call it, addressing the many issues our inmates have, we stand a chance to make a real difference. The conclusion is therefore that every day in prison must count. In our experience, this is particularly important for our young offenders. The juveniles get particularly short sentences. And we have two very good reasons to start working with them already from the first day. We need to reduce the damaging effects of isolation, and we have to make an early assessment of risk, need, and responsivity. We try to use even the time before trial as much as we can to motivate the detainees to treatment and, if needed, studies. We also try hard to establish a good relationship with them already at that stage. Without healthy personal relations, we cannot hope to help anyone realize the kinds of changes that we are looking for. Our experience is that there are often good opportunities during the first weeks or months. Once the juveniles reach the prison, it is much harder to get through to them. Inmates who appear in our service at an early age also normally have many problems and even more needs. In our experience, you cannot work with one factor in isolation from others. Different professions within the prison service have to work with different needs, well coordinated and at the same time. Our problem is this: we do not choose the point in time when we come into our inmates' life. And most young offenders are with us for a very short period of time, and we certainly do not control at what point in time they leave us. Our odds to succeed are therefore not very good. And for that reason, we need to have an exceptionally good plan if we are to stand any chance at all. To be able to work efficiently with our juveniles, we keep them completely separate from other prisoners in very small units, about 6 to 10 inmates per unit. Each one is staffed with a variety of professional resources: teachers, psychologists, prison and probation officers, and treatment staff. They will all work in a coordinated way, preparing his or her release from the very first day to the very last. In other words, there will be very little time left for our juvenile offenders to sit around and do nothing during their time with us. We keep them very busy. Also, the last phase of a prison term, in our view, is very, very important. The time during conditional release cannot, in our opinion, be just supervision. Here we continue with evidence-based cognitive programs to fight the risk of reoffending. We also need to cooperate intensively with other state or communal authorities like the National Employment Service or social services. Someone once told me that the only strategy that really works with young offenders is to let them grow older and wiser. I would very much like to prove him wrong. This brings me to the third and perhaps most important component of our strategy. When we look at our survey data on our inmates and see what problems they have in their lives, it is quite clear that we need to look at the whole picture. We must deal with all the problems they have, not just the ones that got them into prison. And we certainly cannot afford to deal with one problem at a time. Our approach is to work with all the relevant problems all the time, what we call a multimodality approach. If you ignore key factors that can cause reoffending, you will jeopardize your entire effort. And that is why it is so vitally important that you know what these factors are. Let me give you an example of what I mean. About 3 or 4 years ago, our staff in one of our high security prisons became fed up with a group of prisoners. They had been working with them for many, many years. The majority were local offenders with a long history of substance abuse, and they had been offered and enrolled in every conceivable treatment program available to us. We had detoxified them, tried to educate them, offered vocational training, and tried a number of different motivational strategies and advanced therapy. Still, year after year, they kept coming back to us. The message we were getting from our staff was very clear. These people are reoffending because we are not addressing all the issues that they are struggling with. Our personnel were convinced that it was not their drug addiction that was the issue. They were certain that these prisoners had attention deficit syndrome, ADHD. And what they were asking was for headquarters to allow them to offer qualified medical treatment for that diagnosis in conjunction with all the other therapeutic interventions they were already giving. This was a very controversial proposal for us. But we listened carefully to them, and we decided to design a randomized controlled scientific study to find out if there really was a connection between the ADHD diagnosis and risk of reoffending. The results were dramatic. The group of prisoners that were offered active medical treatment in combination with a range of other specifically targeted social programs and therapy responded so remarkably well that we initially had a hard time believing it. These results have since then been confirmed in other scientific studies, and we are now about to launch a nationwide study to further establish the connection between ADHD and the risk of reoffending amongst all our clients and inmates. The point to all this is that part of our challenge is to identify and deal with the underlying factors behind crime and relapse in crime. We now have some very strong scientific evidence suggesting that ADHD is indeed one such factor. If that is true, the implication reaches far beyond the boundaries of prison and probation services. It means that we should probably rethink our whole strategy for helping the children and young adults struggling with this particular syndrome in a much more systematic way and at a much earlier stage of their lives. This is but one illustration of the dynamic character of most of the problems that our inmates are struggling with. The fact that they are dynamic means that most, if not all of them, can in one way or another be assessed and addressed. The only static problem that we cannot change is the criminal history of our inmates and clients. But also in this regard, I believe there are things we as a society should do and should not do. One thing we must do is to make sure that a criminal record does not present more of a burden than it has to. Let me conclude on that note because it is of such an importance. In Sweden, we are currently experiencing increasing stigmatization of people with a criminal record. I don't just mean that there is ignorance and anger about the mechanisms of crime and criminality. There certainly is a fair amount of that too. And as a profession, I think we have not succeeded well in informing the general public what our work is all about. But worse than that, there is also still prejudice in the real sense of the word. Preconceived, strong, and often revengeful ideas about how society should deal with criminals. I say that with sadness and frustration. I live in one of the richest countries in the world, and we pride ourselves on being inhabited by a population that is very highly educated. Most of my fellow Swedes will consider prejudice to be a thing of the past, and still it is clearly alive and doing quite well with regards to our prisoners and clients in probation. Now, this is a real problem for us because it means that we experience increasing difficulties and obstacles in getting civil society involved in what we do. Not only that, but we're also now seeing some commercial initiatives attempting to make money out of the misfortune of people with a criminal record. An increasing number of internet-based companies are now systematically gathering and selling publicly available information on convicted people. This is a new and very unsettling trend. We have, in our country, one of the most transparent public sectors in the entire world. But it was never the idea that sensitive personal data would be commercialized in this way. We need to better recognize that whenever crime and criminals are discussed, there are strong feelings of fear, frustration, and anger involved. The incentives for economic exploitation and political opportunism are there. I don't believe that legislation is going to be able to do much about that. What I would like to see, however, is more of civil courage, more people outside the business of criminal justice taking a firm stand for what I think most people, on reflection, will consider to be principles of basic human decency. If we stop giving people a second chance, then what is the point of it all? The business of prison and probation is about two things: people and change. Our work rests on a few relatively simple principles. Much of our strategy boils down to the need for adequate staff resources. Yes, prison and probation systems are labor intensive and therefore very costly. In my prison service, we have a staff ratio of almost 1-to-1. The consequence is that we are currently the fourth largest state-run organization in the country. I am convinced that the alternative would be even more costly. Another way of putting it is that we have been fortunate enough to have strong political support for what we do and wise politicians who have been prepared to back us financially for a long time. The advantage of that cannot be overstated. In times of economic decline, this is of course difficult to maintain. Prison services around Europe are currently experiencing severe budget cuts, as I said earlier, and so are we. The long-term effects of this, therefore, gives cause for concern. In the end, it must be the results that count. If we reach our goals and manage to increase safety and security in society, it will be money well spent and an investment worth making. I, for one, am firmly believe that anyone who takes the trouble of looking hard at what we do in this business, 7 days a week, 365 days per year, will come to the same conclusion. Let me end by again quoting one of my experienced prison officers. She commented the other day on her relationship to the inmates in the following way. She said, "You know, I'm sometimes sad at the end of my working day, because it's not a criminal I see when I lock the cell door. It is a person. And if there is a code, I think, to be cracked in prison and probation work, it's probably that one. If you can afford to have many people like that on your team, you will succeed sooner or later." Thank you very much for listening.
As a hack, I wrote down some illegible notes. No drugs, no violence. 1% showing any evidence of drug abuse in a prison-wide, across the sector, testing. Unconditional respect for the prisoner. If you don't like the people you work with, or the kind of people you work with, then you cannot work in our prisons. These are statements I don't think we could ever afford to make. We wouldn't have a prison system if we stood by these ideas. make every day in prison count. I thought most of us spend our time counting the days in prison. Absolutely amazing, his thoughts about the criminal record. If we stop giving people a second chance, what's the point of our business? ADHD and reoffending. You can't work with one factor to the isolation of another. Politicians are backing us for the long term. That statement, above all others, is one we could not make. There is an enormous amount to learn from what you've said tonight, and I'm delighted to say Nils will take some questions. I hope there are some questions. I'd like to ask one question, and that is, how much does the electorate know about what you do? Do they know what you're doing? Do they know that you're treating these people like human beings?
Well, yes, they do, but probably not enough. I mean, one of the things, and I think I mentioned it, is that we have not been very good in bringing that message out to the general public. And that is our responsibility. We need to find ways to do that. And I think the preconditions for it are very good, for one simple reason. Almost everybody's interested. You know, when you mention the service and the business and what we do, it catches people's attention. But we have not been very good in exploiting that and telling, you know, the stories. We're getting better at doing that, and we're doing it more systematically, and we're trying to put the good stories out there. So there's been a change for the better, but we're nowhere near where we would like to be.
Questions? In red, down there, the microphone will come to you. If you keep your hand up. Always good to wear red in it.
Well, I thought that was the best and the most important Longford lecture I've heard in the last 10 years. Thank you so much for
Thank
it.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I've got two questions, and they both involve other areas there. One of the main problems we have here is the media. Especially since the Leveson inquiry, the media here has been not at all helpful in a lot of things, and saying what's wrong with prison is one of the problems that we've had, and that the media don't talk about it. You were talking about who's got control of the prisons at the moment. It appears that the prison service has lost control. There was an enormous story recently featuring Highdown Prison, which is in the last few days, which has gone completely unreported in the general media. Do you have a media in Sweden that is positive towards your efforts, or do they actually condemn you? And secondly, the other problem we have here is politicians, where they're not only not good and not supportive, but actively do things that are, I think the word you used was mad. Is it not mad to ban prisoners from receiving books from outside?
I think so. Well, let's see if I understood your questions. I think the first one was whether we had media in Sweden. No, of course we don't. We got rid of those long time ago. No, I know there's a fair amount of criticism I've understood in this country as to the role of the media. Yes, we have a media. I would like to answer that question by saying I think there are pretty much the same mechanisms in my country as it is here. As I said, there's a fair amount of fear, there's prejudice, there are very strong opinions about criminal justice and people committing crime. So there's no difference. And I, for one, think that no, in my country, media has a very small role to play in that respect. Those sentiments and those feelings are present in every society that I know, regardless of how, you know, media is acting. You just simply have to accept that people who commit crimes are going to generate those kinds of fears in society, and you need to come up with a strategy to deal with it, regardless of the role of media. So I do not think that media is the problem. We have many other problems, but media is certainly not one of them. Now, on politicians, yes, it's true, we've had strong support in the political system. The criminal justice system is not part of the political debate, I think, the way it is in your country. We have just had national elections, and there have been very, very few questions regarding the construction of the criminal justice system in general and the way we run operations in particular. So in our society, in our country, as I said in the beginning, it's very, you know, the political context is very different, I think.
Questions? Yes, one down here. And then another microphone, if you could get over to there. I don't know how many microphones we have. Keep your hand up and the microphone will come to you. He's going out, he'll come back in, and so keep it up.
Juliet Donovan, criminal barrister. I work a lot with young people.
Yes.
And most of them have lost or are estranged from their fathers and their families. So I was wondering, is there anything that you do in your country to try and promote reuniting the families and trying to bring the young offenders back with their families? Is there any system or anything in place to try and promote that?
I think most of the time, families can be a very positive force for change in our clients' life. Unfortunately, sometimes it's the opposite. So I think there's not one answer to that question. And as I said, we try to work with all the problems that our inmates have and often have had for a long time. So yes, family relations, broken social structures is definitely going to be one arena where we try to do things. We're fortunate because we have many non-governmental organizations in our country who are committed and engaged in helping out when it comes to families and parents and children. We as a service have no mandate to do that. We only work with the people that we are responsible for. But we have extensive cooperation with the non-governmental community in promoting and supporting and helping re-establish family relations. It's very, very important.
The question over here. And let's find the next question. Yes, if you could get the one. Go for it.
Thank you very much indeed for a very inspiring presentation. My name is Alison Frater. I work in public health and currently working on women offending. John, your comments at the beginning were very interesting with the comparison with the proportion of women in prison. And indeed, it is very small in the UK in comparison with the total population, but it is nevertheless a population that is too big. There are far too many women in prison in the UK. And the numbers have risen enormously over the last 10 years, and we really do need to see a downward trend in that. I'm really interested to know what proportion of women you do have in prisons in Sweden and how you're addressing the gender-specific needs of women offenders.
Well, thank you for that question. It's an important one. I think we have less than 10% of our inmate population are women. We have done quite a bit of scientific research, actually, on our female inmate population, trying to figure out, you know, what differs them from our male population. And there are many differences. And one of the things that we have failed historically is to recognize those differences and adapt the way we work for the needs of our female population. We're now trying to change that, as we can see that they have in many, many areas, different needs than our male client and inmate population. For one thing, they are often in a much worse shape than the male population, psychologically, psychiatrically, and physically. So there's a much bigger health issue with our female population. Also, we need to, you know, take into consideration that in order to reintegrate women back into society, first of all, I believe that for some peculiar reason, they are even more stigmatized than male offenders. And that needs to be recognized. I also think that some of these women professionally come from typically, you know, female professions like healthcare and education and so forth and so on. If they have committed a crime against a person, it means that they will effectively be barred from their professions for the rest of their lives. So for many of them, they will have to reorient their professions with their professional ambitions in completely different areas, which of course for us means a completely different set of challenges because we have to start from the beginning again. I can talk a long time about this, but the short answer is yes. We are now trying to reorient our strategies for our female offenders and try to find strategies that are gender neutral. Treating male and female prisoners the same way is going to generate many inequalities. That's our opinion, at least.
If your 10% is right, then it's rather interesting because it's slightly higher than ours.
I think it's actually.
That would make it about 3,000.
I think it's actually 6%. Yes.
It would sound as if both of us have many more than the Dutch, for example, who at one point got down to about a matter of a couple of hundred.
Okay, I didn't know that.
But I'm not sure what the position now is. But people have shown that it's possible to imprison very few women.
Yeah, no, I think it's 6% in prison, and I think it's slightly higher in probation. Actually, that's why I'm confusing the figures.
Right. Oh, we've got a question up there. Well, what fun. Let's just take one. Well, I'll come back to you.
Hello.
Let's go up
is
there.
This on? Yeah. Hello, my name is Sandra Barefoot. I work for the Forgiveness Project in the Restore Programme. I wanted to ask you something. Recently, we ran a programme with prison officers. Our first one, 20 prison officers went through the Restore Programme. Their stories were immense. Their stories outside of their work was full of so much trauma and so much suffering. And opposite each other, they said to each other, I've known you for 12 years, and I didn't know that was your story that you're living with, and you come into this prison every day to work with these prisoners, and yet you're suffering with your own story. And I wanted to ask you, because I'm really inspired by how you talk about the prison officer saying, you cannot work in my team. What is the training you give to your prison officers that really support them? Because I know most professions, people are drawn to that profession because of their own stories. So I just wanted to ask you, what is the training you offer them?
Well, we have a basic training, which is, I think, about 20 weeks long. We've actually had to shorten it a little bit for financial reasons. And we've redone it completely just recently. So it's a brand new basic training that we have. We've tried to compose it in an intelligent way, taking into account, you know, the need to have a sound, you know, knowledge about the rules and regulations that needs to be applied. I mean, all these hard competences that you need, but also to have a very strong social component in there, meaning that there are also modules of social relations and behavioral science and so forth and so on. But it's important for us that when we train our prison officers, we train them for the first day on the job, not the last day on the job, which means that we're also now constructing a series of training modules that they will be offered during the course of their career, so that you can orient yourself into various, you know, special fields, whether you want to work with young offenders or female offenders or violent offenders or sexual offenders and so forth and so on. So we're trying to create a whole series of different paths that you can pursue as a prison and probation officer and the relevant education for that.
We're right out of time. We'll take one last question. I promised one here.
Killer drivers and fraudsters. I'm a judge. Sentencing is part of my daily job. The general rule is that sentencing for very serious crimes, such as murder and rape, is very easy. It's prison for a long time. The more difficult one is, for example, driving carelessly and killing the young man who turns out of a minor road onto a main road and kills a disabled child on a pedestrian crossing. I had that case. What would the judge in Sweden do in that case, the killer driver? Or another case I've recently had.
No, let's stick with the one.
Okay, just that one. Killer drivers, young men, death by careless driving.
I don't think I have the answer to that. the system we have is that we come in as a service also in that process. So what will happen is that the judge in question will put the question to us in view of the trial, saying, this is the case, this is the individual, please advise me as to what the, not whether he or she is guilty or not, but what do you think as a service would be an appropriate sentence? Not in terms of length, but what do you expect that you can do with an individual of that kind? And on the basis of that proposal, then the judge will take his or her decision. So it's not an easy answer to a question to answer, but we try to have an interaction with the courts. Many times this individual will be somebody that we know from the past. So we will have a pretty good idea of what we've done before, if that person has been in the service at some point in time. So the system works well for us because it means that we can give the court system and the judges a lot of information on the individual at hand, and hopefully we will get a wise sentence in return.
Well, even the final answer contained within it all sorts of unimaginable elements. The thought of a judge calling the prisoner a service up and saying, look into this, see what kind of sentence would make a difference. I mean, amazing. Let us hope the word goes forth. Somebody read, you've got a book? Have you written it? Well, no. They'll read your speech at least.
Okay.
Let's hope they read your speech and want to know more and want to do more.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much indeed. I'm afraid we've hopelessly overrun, but I'm afraid it was excusable. I would like just now to call up, as a part of our final moment tonight, Peter Stanford, who is the remarkable director of the Longford Trust, without whom this evening certainly would not have occurred, and much else, nor indeed with the Longford Scholarships Program, which he will talk about in a moment, which helps young offenders to go to university. Peter.
Okay, thank you very much. Haven't got time for clapping, we've overrun slightly. But I promise to do this very quickly. But for the past 10 years, we've been running, sorry, people behind as well, I know you've been slightly left out. We've been running a Longford Scholarship Programme, which helps young ex-offenders who want to study for degrees at university. And those of you who've been here before will have known that a couple of our current scholars come up and just tell you a little bit about their work. So I'm going to ask Malia, Brian, Mark, and Imogen, just to come up here very quickly. Come and join me here. You come on this side. Come on this side. We'll start with Imogen first. Got a terrible echo here, but anyway. Imogen, you may recognize from last year. Imogen is studying geology at Southampton University. But the reason I wanted Imogen to come back and have a very quick word with you today is one of the best things about our scholarship program is the mentoring part of it. And Imogen's been working with her mentor this year. And your mentor arranged a rather wonderful thing for you to do in the summer, didn't he, Imogen?
There's a cue. Sup? So he organized for me to go to Tanzania and work on a gold mine, which is what I want to do when I finish university. So that was amazing. I arrived with absolutely no intention of being social. I was going to work really hard. And the first thing someone said to me was, there's tequila and a barbecue down by the lake. Do you want to come? Why, yes, I do.
And you did some geology too.
That was day one. From there on, there was more rocks involved. It was fantastic. It was exactly what I want to do. It's just completely confirmed in my mind that I'm doing the right degree, and I got a fantastic tan in the process. So,
um,
I tried to tempt Imogen's mentor to come up on stage and tell me what it was like, that mentor-mentee relationship. But in the absence, in his modesty, I've brought up two other people here. This is Mark Laurie, who's come all the way down from Scotland, and this is Bran Carlin, who's Mark's mentor. So if I can ask Imogen and Bran just to swap places quickly. Mark on this side. Mark, first of all, tell me you've just completed your degree, haven't you? Tell me what your degree was in, and then tell me what it was like working with Brian as your mentor. Be nice.
As Peter said, I'm from Scotland, I'm from Glasgow, so I'll speak slowly, so everyone gets me.
All one country.
I just graduated with a BSc Honours in Sport and Exercise Science. Bit of a journey because in 2007 I received a prison sentence for drug dealing, basically. So coming all that way and with a massive help from the Longford and the support, gave me a bit of belief and a bit of confidence and a bit of reassurance as well. And they gave me my mentor Brian, who offered me offered me support as well, somebody to vent to, somebody that I could kind of moan at. And somebody to give me a bit of advice, and again, a bit of reassurance and confidence when I needed it. So other than just the financial help from the scholarship, there is the other side to it as well.
Brilliant, Mark, thank you. And Brian, you'll see in your programmes the notes about our mentoring programme. So Brian, tell us what it's like being a mentor.
Immensely rewarding. I mean, when Peter asked me to do this, I just couldn't refuse. And when it was in one of my favorite subjects, sport and exercise science, I thought, well, that's right up my street. And it was a fellow Scotsman, so absolutely, I was going to support him. And having been through higher education at master's level, it was easy to understand that when you are studying, there are many, many areas that you can slip and trip and fall and fail. And if I could share any of my experience to help someone else through some very difficult and challenging times, then, you know, I think more people should be doing it. So if anyone is thinking that they have life experiences that they could share, that they could support a Longford mentoring scheme, then I'd ask you to get in touch with Peter and offer your services.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. And finally, one of the great things that we've been able to do in building up this scholarship programme is build particular relationships with university. And Malio, you're at Westminster University, aren't you? One of the brilliant things Westminster have done, and if there are any other senior people from universities here, Westminster, for any Longford scholar who goes along there, waive the tuition fees. Pretty good, isn't it? Yay. But Malio, tell me, what's your degree at Westminster and how's it going?
I'm doing a history and politics degree. I got a 2-1 last year, and I'm going to get a first.
And how much has it helped having a Longford scholarship and a Longford mentor working with you?
Well, it's only been 2 months, but I really appreciate it. And I think it's just having another perspective on what you're doing that really helps you navigate between your decisions.
Well, listen, people were a bit shy about coming out, so I hope you'll give everyone a round of applause. Thank you. Okay. One thing I did want to mention to you as well in relation to our Longford scholarships is you may remember a couple of years ago a young man called Lee Cutter came and stood up with me here, who was doing a fine art degree at Sunderland. Lee has now graduated and is working as an artist. And one of the brilliant things that he's done recently, any of you who know the Kirstler Awards, they have an exhibition on the South Bank at the moment, and Lee has curated a room there of art done by other people who are in prison at the moment. The exhibition is still on. I wanted to bring the whole room here, but I couldn't. But we've got some boards showing what it's like. And Lee, just stand up so everyone will know who you are. This is Lee, who's wonderful. And at the end of the lecture, Lee, the two rooms here, remember, there's the Hoare Memorial Hall over there where there are drinks, but there's also the Bishop Partridge Hall where there are drinks, and Lee is going to be in there with his board. And I'd love you just to go and listen to him telling you about the artwork that he chose there, because it is fascinating and moving. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for listening. Back to you, John.
Well, finally, can I ask Kevin Pakenham, Lord Longford's youngest son and chair of the Longford Trust, just to come to the lectern to say a few words about fundraising.
Thank you very much, John, and thank you, I must say, to Peter, Maggie, Robin, and Jill, without whom the Longford Trust wouldn't happen. But even more important, thank you all for coming this evening. As last year, it's my privilege to conclude the events, and it's also my duty to talk on the always fascinating question of money. To sugar this pill, let me tell you that I'm standing to thank you for your generosity and to give you some line of sight as to where the money goes. Should I berate you with requests for more money? I'm told that last year I was too feeble in my request for cash and that I should have been more forceful. I've considered this criticism very carefully. So let me bring you up to date. In our last full year, we raised just short of £98,000. But much more spectacularly, you have contributed in this year to date £164,000. And that is despite my feeble requests last year. So I'm hopeful that you will be even more generous on the next 12 months as a result of these very forceful words. 3,250 came from donations in tickets for the lecture. As you know, this lecture is free and literally everyone is welcome. We do ask people to make a donation. We suggest £10, but it's not really to us to put a price on it. It's up to you to decide what it's worth. So let me say, as I asked you last year, let the spirit move you. The vast majority of our money therefore comes from individuals, donations, and we also get help from charitable trusts and companies, but we have no endowment. So we live off what we raise each year. Where does the money go? £12,000 goes on this lecture. £55,000 last year was spent on the scholarships. Our direct costs, which are almost entirely employment, are £25,000, but fortunately, two-thirds of that is provided by a particular trust. Remarkably, the mentoring is all done for free. In terms of free hours put in, the trust is astoundingly well served. And people are genuinely, incredibly generous with their time. Looking ahead, the main constraint on our scholarship activity is money. This summer, we awarded 19 new Longford scholarships, which compares with the 13 that we gave last year and directly reflects the spectacular increase in the amount that we've raised this year. Each scholar costs £3,600 spread over 3 years, and the only constraint on the number of scholarships we give is the amount of money we're able to raise. So thank you once again for your support and for coming here this evening. Everyone is welcome. But as chairman of the trustees, let me reiterate that those who have given so generously are no less welcome than anyone else. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Kevin. And enormous thanks again to Nils Oberg. Thanks to our sponsors, the Daily Telegraph and Charlie Porter. Thanks to the Prison Reform Trust, our partners in organising tonight's lecture. Thanks to tonight's ushers, volunteers from the Cardinal Vaughan Memorial School in West London, and that invitation for everyone to join the Longford Prize winners for drinks and canapes and Longford Scholars, catered by the Clink, which you should look at the website and find out what they do. They are quite remarkable. They do cordon bleu cooking in prisons, which the general public can eat, not the prisons, but the food. In the Hall Memorial Hall, the Bishop Partridge Hall, it all awaits you. Please join me and everyone else, and we'll have a good natter. Thank you very much. Thank you.